Hey everyone, I am Nathaniel Rumpeljantz, and we are launching or relaunching a new series here at the Nintendo Prime YouTube channel called Zelda Inquiries. You can go back and watch some of the old episodes back when it was the Zelda Informer YouTube channel if you want. Things are going to be a little different this time around because it's not just going to be like a static image with some particle effects, and it's not just going to be me on camera. My goal is to bring in all of the faces that are talking about Zelda for you. Because I've been running Zelda stuff for, 18 years, I said? Almost 19 now. So it's one of those things where I have a huge passion for Zelda. I'm always going to have a huge passion for Zelda. And I'm going to be bringing on other people that have also a huge passion for Zelda to talk about Zelda with you guys every single week. So on this very first inaugural episode of Zelda Inquiries, I have someone who I know is a big Zelda fan. I've been on his channel actually talking about Zelda before. And that would be Mr. Game Over Jesse.
Hi, everybody. Happy to be here.
And then a good old pal who helped me out on the Zelda Informer podcast randomly after I asked for people to help out on Twitter way back in the day. Has his own YouTube channel, Mason of Delfino.
Hey, what's going on, guys?
And as you'll see in his video, he might have the biggest Nintendo collection I've personally seen from someone I actually know. Like, I've seen pictures of someone who has, like, the biggest collection in the world, but I've never talked to that person, but I have talked to you. And the thing is, you have that huge collection, and how old are you?
I'm 19. It started when I was 15, almost, so.
That is such a huge collection.
It started out with the Mario poster. It snowballed from there, so.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. So, we're here, obviously, to talk about some Zelda. And for those who don't know, Zelda Inquiries is a show or kind of a discussion, a roundtable, where we talk about either topics that I really want to talk about this week, or it'll be stuff that primarily you guys bring up. So down in the comment section here on YouTube or on social media or wherever you have seen this that has Nintendo Prime as the primary place, because I'm not going to go to other people's websites to read their comment sections. You can just leave a comment and ask a question for us to talk about. So bring up a topic. You know, you want us to talk about the ever-present cheek gender debate for some reason. Go ahead and bring it up, and that is something that we will talk about on the following episode. So let's just get into what the topics are this week. And we're going to start with a few people on Facebook who have a couple interesting questions. And I'm going to snowball this a little bit based on something that Alfred, who is the host of the Zelda Informer podcast, which I will throw a link down to that podcast in the description for you guys, brought up in a recent episode. And this comes from Leon Howard on the Nintendo Prime Facebook page. It says, will we see Demise anytime soon? And I'm going to add a caveat to this. Alfred brought up an idea that Demise and Calamity Ganon could be very closely related. So, let's talk about this.
All right.
Obviously, you guys know who Demise is, right?
See, okay, yeah, real quick. I've never heard of that up until this game.
You never heard of Demise?
No, I have not. That is one thing I'm clueless on with this.
Okay, so Demise is actually from Skyward Sword.
Okay, see, I never played that game.
And this is kind of cool. Like, here we go. So for any of our viewers that haven't actually played Skyward Sword, because Mason of Delfino is not the only one out there, right?
Skyward Sword was skipped by a lot of people. So
yes, yeah. So let me just explain who Demise is, because Demise is kind of an important character in Zelda lore. So Demise was, spoiler warning by the way for Skyward Sword. Demise is kind of the enemy character that set up a giant curse on everything. Demise is basically the reason that Ganondorf and all the other various enemies happen. Because when Link defeats him at the end of Skyward Sword, he, with his dying breath, which it's interesting if it's his dying breath because he gets sealed inside the Master Sword. It's really weird. But he throws out a curse that every single time Link or a character like Link exists, an evil is going to rise up. So, essentially, it just means that Hyrule is going to be in a perpetual war for all time.
Yeah.
And that's Demise's importance to the story. And we have never seen Demise again, ever, because he just didn't even exist. Like, Skyward Sword went back and retconned a bunch of stuff, because that's just what Nintendo does.
Yeah.
So that's Demise's overall importance to the series, is he is now the excuse for why there's always another Zelda game, basically.
Yeah, I think it was Nintendo's easy way out of being trying to explain why there's always Zelda at the same time there's Link, at the same time there's a big daddy. Yeah. So it was their plot device to be like, okay, well, we can do this, and then he's the reason they keep reincarnating over and over and over.
And I have to say, Demise looks like a badass.
He does.
Giant beast, long flowing hair.
I posted a thing the other day on Twitter saying something like Broly from Dragon Ball Z.
Yeah.
Plus Ganondorf equals Demise.
So I guess I'll throw this one at Game Over Jesse, since he obviously knows a bit more backstory here, or a lot more than Mason.
Right, yeah.
Right. So, like, do you think Demise is going to return anytime soon? And do you think there's any relation to Calamity Ganon?
Well, there's always, like, how we just got done saying that Ganondorf and presumably all the other baddies, like Zant or whoever, is basically Demise just reincarnated with a different look or whatever. But Calamity Ganon doesn't, at this point in time, look like he really has a physical form. So it could just be like the manifestation of the evil or the power, the corruption that was Demise. Because we've seen Demise in his human or humanoid form, which was Demise, but then he also had his beast form, like how Ganondorf has Ganon. He had the Imprisoned, which was like his monster beast form or whatever. So presumably there could be a connection between the two beast forms, but I don't know.
Like, yeah, it's hard because, like, Skyward Sword is the most recent console Zelda game to come out. So, like, Demise is relatively a new character to Zelda fans. Lore-wise, he's not new, because Skyward Sword is listed as the very first game in the Zelda timeline right now. There are events that happen before Skyward Sword, so they could potentially make a game before Skyward Sword if they want. But it's one of those things that, even though lore-wise he's at the beginning of the timeline, he's a relatively new character, which means he doesn't really have a lot of stapled history in terms of showing up over the years. So, like, when I think, you know, is Demise going to return anytime soon, I don't know if he can return, right? Because the way everything's set up, it seemed to almost be like he was intentionally a one-off enemy that is supposed to explain why all those other enemies exist. But in a way, I said, it's really weird how Skyward Sword ends, because, like, it tries to portray that it's his dying breath he puts that curse out there. But then it's also inferred that he's sealed inside the Master Sword, which is why we have to say goodbye to Fi, or Fi. Because she has to sacrifice her being as a character to live inside the sword forever to keep him sealed. So in theory, if somehow Fi got separated, pulled out of the sword, it could potentially break the seal and Demise could come back. So, like, it's really weird. So, like, the curse happens as he's dying, but he doesn't really die. This is, like, Zelda does this all the time. Like, how many times has Ganondorf died but not died?
Yeah. It's like a Bowser situation almost.
Yeah, kind of, except Bowser's always there. He's right. Ever present. Yeah. Like, Demise hasn't been.
Right.
Really, Ganondorf hasn't technically been either. I think it's maybe half of the games have Ganon or Ganondorf, or even less than half. Because there's, what, 18 Zelda games?
Something like that.
Or about to be 19 or something. There's a lot of Zelda games. So it's interesting trying to think of him coming back, because I just gave a scenario where Demise could, in theory, come back. Whether or not Nintendo's ever going to explore that, I have no idea. Jesse brought up an interesting point where, like, because of how the curse works, you can argue that all the bad guys are, like, reincarnations of Demise. I've never really thought about it like that, I guess. Because it kind of is, right? They exist because of him. Like, that's what lore says.
Yeah, that's the idea that I had whenever I finished the game, was that's the reason that there's always a new Zelda who we find out is the reincarnation of the goddess Hylia. There's always the hero Link who is the reincarnation. That's why I think most of the time they always say he possesses the spirit of the hero.
Yeah.
And right. Then all of the bad guys are just not necessarily saying Ganondorf is a reincarnation of Demise, but the evil that makes him want to take over Hyrule or conquer and have everything his own is the evil from Demise.
Yeah, it's just a really interesting topic. So, like, to kind of throw this back at you, you know, Leon, or anyone else who's curious, like, do you guys think Demise is going to come back? Do you think he's already been back because he reincarnates? You know, is that something you subscribe to? Do you see, like, what Alfred from the Zelda Informer podcast, like, suggested to me, you know, that maybe Calamity Ganon is, you know, it is potentially Demise, and that what we're seeing is even because there's no physical form yet, that we're seeing him break out. And we just know him, at that time in Hyrule's history, they know him as Calamity Ganon, but we later find out it's actually Demise.
Yeah, there, one thing that I want to say is, in the timeline, this is going, you know, very, going full nerd into the timeline. Okay. Skyward Sword happened, you know, it was the most recent Zelda game, but as you were saying earlier, it takes place at the very beginning of the timeline.
Yeah, it's the oldest game lore-wise.
All right, potentially thousands of years before any of the games that take place around like the middle of the
girth of the timeline.
Yeah, like any game after Ocarina of Time presumably happens like 1,000 or so years after the first game, Skyward Sword. So over time you would likely forget the name Demise or whatever. Mm-hmm. And the most current evil that's trying to take over the world that you know is likely Ganon or Ganondorf from Ocarina of Time. So if that name Ganondorf gets passed down, or Ganon gets passed down, then anytime anyone sees something that's like this big evil beast trying to take over, whether it's Demise or something else entirely, they're still going to look at it as if it was Ganon. So that could be it, or it could just simply be Nintendo being like, oh, let's use Ganon again. Last time we had a home console Zelda game, we used Demise. Let's go back to Ganon.
Sure. But yeah, it's one of those things that there is a chance that maybe it already is Demise and we find that out. Or we don't find that out. I don't know. They mess around with stuff so much, it's hard to know. But seriously, Leon, thanks for your question. Obviously, if you guys out there, you know, listening or watching, have any, you know, any of your own theories on that, that'd be great. You know, I would love to see Demise come back, but I kind of have a feeling that Ganon / Ganondorf is kind of where they're going to keep going. And there's nothing wrong with that, because he's obviously one of the iconic bad guys in all of Zelda.
Yeah. And the last time that we had Ganondorf in a home console Zelda game was Twilight Princess, which was over 10 years ago. So I think 10 years is long enough to see the return of Ganon.
Well, the thing is, like, what's also interesting is that in Breath of the Wild, he's called Calamity Ganon, right? So, yeah. Like, Ganon, the last time we actually saw Ganon, last time we saw him lore-wise was in the Downfall timeline, with the old-school games from the 80s and 90s. But the last time, like, in terms of, like, a 3D console game was Ocarina of Time, when Ganondorf became Ganon for the final boss fight. So it's kind of interesting, the dynamics there, and obviously we could talk about timeline placement and lots of stuff, which we might actually get into later. I think there's a question on Breath of the Wild for timeline. So let's move on to the next topic, and this one comes from someone who I recognize from the old Zelda Informer days, because, you know, those days aren't actually behind me yet, because it's not April 30th. At WPeaceBoy on, what is this, Twitter? Yeah, the old Twitter. He has a kind of a Breath of the Wild related question. He asks, what is Link in Breath of the Wild? Is he a human? Is he a Hylian? Is he an alien? And he jokingly says, perhaps a man in a box. And he says, that's because no one lives 100 years. No one sleeps for 100 years and actually lives through it. Partially a joke, partially serious, obviously. You know, We haven't, like, it hasn't happened as far as we're aware in Hyrule history that any character, beyond maybe Ganondorf himself, has kind of just laid around for 100 years. and came back, right?
Right.
So, like, what do you guys think this means? Like, is this just the natural evolution for the series, a natural evolution and maybe technology they have that makes that possible? Or is it because, you know, maybe we find out, like, we always were told all these years that, like, Link is a Hylian, but maybe he's a mixed race. And mixed with, like, some other race, maybe it's the Sheikah or something, that enable him to persist. Like, if we think about some of the characters that seem to live the longest, it's always, like, Impa or Ganondorf. It's never a Hylian.
You mentioned the Sheikah. I believe, wasn't there some kind of rumors, like, or some kind of theory, rather, that said Link could have been a Sheikah because of, like, the technology, the blue tunic he's wearing and stuff. It's just, like, the technology involved, he has a Sheikah slate, and everything that goes, like, through the technology and everything is linked back to that. You know what I mean?
Personally, I think the Sheikah, like, they're always called the Sheikah tribe or whatever, which right. I guess there's also the Rito tribe.
Yeah.
But I look at, like, the Zoras, the Hylians,
right.
the Gerudos, whatever. I look at those as races, and I look at the Sheikah as, like, a title or a job. To where anyone, like, if you're a Zora, potentially you could be part of the Sheikah tribe. I don't really look at the Sheikah as their own race. I look at it as, like, the protectors or the police for the Hylian royal family.
Yet they seem to live a long time. Obviously, Impa is the most well-known because, like, that's what's so interesting about Breath of the Wild in general is we might finally get some insight into Sheikah. That we've never had before. But even when you go into, like, the shrines in the game, those are some really old Sheikah people at the end.
Yeah.
Like, really old.
Yeah, and they disappear, like, as soon as you finish the shrine.
Yeah, so it's kind of, it's like, to me at least, it feels like the Sheikah tribe is one of those tribes that they just live a long time. And that's, what, I guess, maybe why I refer to it almost as a race, because I don't, we don't haven't seen evidence that, like, a Hylian can live that long, or a Zora, or, you know, a Goron. You know, we do have evidence technically of a Gerudo because of Ganondorf, but again, there's also a special case where the Gerudo have, like, a new male Ganondorf or a new male thing, like, what, once every 1,000 years or something.
Yeah, he also has the Triforce of Power, so that could prolong his life.
Make him a special use case. But they don't have that. The Sheikah tribe don't have, like, a Triforce. You know, they have magical abilities, clearly. But, I don't know. I guess maybe that's why I never really... I don't know. Like, the Sheikah tribe, you know, has always been described, you know, as, like, protectors of the royal family. You know, occasionally protectors of the Triforce. And they've always had, like, magic or a lot of mystery around them. I just wonder if there's something about what they do that allows them to live so long.
It could just be the magic and the spells that they use. They could use it on themselves to prolong their lives, just as I was saying, Ganondorf could potentially use the Triforce to prolong his life. But we don't really know. It's just there's been, like, maybe two or three actual Hylians that have looked like they were really, really old. Like, there's usually the old man that is pictured in a lot of the Zelda games. But other than that, there's not really, like, a group of old people, whereas almost every time we see a Sheikah or a member of the Sheikah tribe, aside from Zelda in Ocarina of Time, that becomes Sheik, there's usually, they're always depicted as being ancient or really old or whatever. Mm-hmm. Even Impaz in Twilight Princess was another one that was really old.
Yeah, it's just interesting. And I'm hoping we learn more about this throughout the game. You know, like, to answer your question quite literally, Peace Boy, he's obviously Hylian. And the fact that he sleeps for 100 years has to do with some technology thing. If you want a real-world comparison, you can kind of look at it similar to the theory behind cryogenic freezing.
Yeah.
It is a theory. It is something that should technically be possible. We just don't have the technology to do it yet. But this is a video game. They have the technology.
There was also the recent interview with Aonuma and Miyamoto where they said Link wasn't human. Yeah. That was the Game Informer one, I believe.
Okay. Yeah, see, I don't... was that just today or yesterday?
It was the one where they had the 51 questions.
Oh, yeah, it's like rapid-fire questions.
Yeah, you know how weird that one was?
Yeah, they...
I don't know what to believe.
They jokingly teased Paper Zelda.
Yeah, it's like, I don't... That was a really fun interview, but I just don't know if how much of that... I mean, I'll probably throw some clips of it up here in the video, but I don't know how much of that you could believe.
Right, like, it's one of the things you can't really take that seriously, I don't think.
Like, are they being real? Like we Link's last name is Link?
Yeah, no, yeah. I was just about to bring that up because like, he didn't mention that.
I thought the funniest part was they said, what's the secret to being happy or something like that?
Oh, yeah.
Aonuma said, forget everything.
Yeah, and I think Miyamoto said something that was like the exact opposite of that.
Yeah.
It's like, oh my gosh. Anyway, so thanks for your question, Peace Boy. Obviously, it's always nice having those really out there ones, you know. So I'm just going to be this isn't really a question. I mean, I guess it is, but it's a riddle. So at or a tongue twister, I don't know. At Aaron the Schwaj on Twitter said, "How many links could a link of a link could link links?"
7.
Oh wow,
that's the thing. It's like it's not much of a tongue twister because it's the same word every time. But,
right.
It was a nice attempt. I'll give you a little slow clap here. Anyways. So I don't know if this person's serious, but I think they are because they asked two questions and the second one's pretty legit. But I'll cover the first one quick because it has to be because they just didn't pay attention when they played the game. At Nintog Drawing, the first question he says is, what is the castle that appears under the sea in Wind Waker? I mean, the game tells you, but it's Hyrule Castle.
Mm-hmm.
So short and sweet. Hyrule got flooded, and that's the castle. So
maybe it was a thing where they were just watching their older brother or someone like that playing, and they just called.
Yeah.
It.
So like, I'm not trying to like say it's a bad question. It's just like kind of obvious, I guess.
Right.
But there we go. If you didn't know, now you know. It's Hyrule Castle down there, which is why like Zelda becomes Zelda down there, and the king becomes a king. Yada yada yada. But his second question brings up a topic that I hate talking about. But he asks, is Link dead in Majora's Mask? Or what is happening? You guys have some thoughts on that?
I think it is the stupidest Zelda theory that I've ever heard. Like, I mean, the obvious thing, the quickest way to disprove it is the Hero Shade or whatever in Twilight Princess is an adult skeleton, and it's been confirmed that that is the Link from Ocarina of Time and Majora's Mask. So if Link died as a child in Majora's Mask, and that's all a dream or whatever, he's in limbo, whatever the theory suggests, then potentially the Hero Shade you see in Twilight Princess should be a child skeleton instead of a fully grown adult's skeleton. So I think that's the easiest way to just disprove that without
magic.
Going, yeah, magic.
Well, it's the thing, like some people use that skeleton thing as evidence that it happened. Because what happens when you get lost in the Lost Woods?
You turn into the stole child. No, crap.
We'll put you on the spot here.
Yeah.
Yeah, you were basically on the right track. So it's just, the thing is like, there's ways to disprove that because that's what a Kokiri becomes. That's not what a Hylian becomes. That's always been the kind of the caveat with, what happens when a Kokiri gets lost in the Lost Woods, because that's all we hear about is what happens to a Kokiri, not what happens to a Hylian. And you could obviously explain that it's, like, to counter your argument for it, that magic, just, it is what it is. But it's interesting because I think the biggest discredit comes from Twilight Princess, but doesn't come from the fact that, you know, that's the Hero of Time. It comes from the fact that Hyrule Historia mentions that Link in like the actual Link you play as in Twilight Princess is a blood descendant from the Ocarina of Time Link.
Yeah.
So like that means he had to be old enough to like have children. And that doesn't mean that like he couldn't have did that as a child, but I just don't see Link from Ocarina of Time as a child impregnating someone. It's technically possible. I just don't think that happened. And I don't think Nintendo would ever infer that happened. So I always thought this theory was interesting because it works off the premise of the actual themes of the game. Like, death is a big theme in Majora's Mask. Like, it's undeniable. But here, you know, as much as you want to talk about the theories around this, I could just tell you exactly why this is wrong. And it's because Eiji Onoma, the guy who created the game, said this isn't what happened. He actually said that this theory and the five stages of grief that was the original theory was just the five stages of grief, and then it turned into the Link is Dead theory. Which the five stages of grief was started by some old Bombers writer at Zelda Informer, like, I don't know, 8 years ago. So I'm sorry for running. I ran Zelda Informer back then. We kind of started this theory. But Eiji Onoma came out and he stated very plainly that as cool of an idea that is, like, he thinks it's great that fans like read into the games like this. He said that if that is the only thing you take away from those areas, that you are missing out on a lot of their intended emotional impacts of those various areas. So, like, if you only look at each section as a different stage of grief, you are missing out on the other intended emotions, which means it's not part of the five stages of grief. Because there's supposed to be multiple emotions being evoked from every area. So it's one of those things where Eiji Onoma said that's not the case, so that's not what it is. Link doesn't die. And Hyrule Historia clearly points that Link went on, became an adult, had children, etc. Probably with Milan, I know. Shipping Milan and Link again.
Is it Milan?
Oh, I don't know. No, I don't.
I don't either. I used to call her Milan, but then someone corrected me saying it was Malin. And I was like,
Malin, I don't know. It's just like Ocarina versus Ocarina. Like, whatever. We all know what we're talking about, right? So that's kind of at least my thoughts on it, because Eiji Onoma said it's not real. As for what's happening in Majora's Mask, it's a parallel universe. Obviously, they went through some sort of time-traveling whole thing. And, Link got out of it. And the Happy Mask Salesman apparently could freely travel between worlds.
Yeah, and it's not the first parallel world. There's always been, like, Lurule, the Dark World, the Sacred Realm, all those places.
So it's just kind of... Majora's Mask is a... Termina is a place that's having a rough time and been through a lot.
To put it lightly.
And Link basically fixes everything before he leaves. If you do all the side quests, he fixes everything. So, and it's kind of cool because Majora's Mask was actually this is a fun note. It's the first game in the Zelda series that technically has multiple endings. And supposedly Breath of the Wild has multiple endings. So... I know a lot of people are like, oh my god, it's multiple endings, it's good to tell a bad story. I'm like, really? Most people think Majora's Mask story is one of the better ones, and that technically had multiple
endings. Well, also...
So did Spirit Tracks.
Was Link's Awakening before Majora's Mask or after?
Link's Awakening?
Yeah.
Link's Awakening was released before.
Okay.
But Link's Awakening also was just a dream, so it never happened. Sorry to ruin that game for people. Technically, Link's Awakening never happened. Link was just passed out in the ocean the whole
time. And then Link awakened, up. But no, I know...
Hence Link's Awakening.
Right. I was going to say, Breath of the Wild has DLC coming out through the summer, winter, holiday, whatever. That in the second DLC pass, there's another story. Now, would that add to a different part of the Breath of the Wild timeline, or would that just be a carryover of what we already have? You know?
I have no idea. The thing is, what's interesting, they call it an original story.
Is it a whole other game in itself, just with the same world, or what, you know?
Or do you play as a different character?
I think it would be, that would be a prologue or an epilogue, to where it either, like, you go through the game as Link trying to find out what happened. Maybe it lets you play as Zelda doing all of the things that she has to do to... like, set everything up. We see that she takes the Master Sword to the Deku Tree and all of this other stuff. Maybe it's you playing her on her journey while Link's in his slumber.
Or it's like what probably people want even more than that, even though I think that's a really cool idea. Like, I would love to explore Zelda's side of everything, especially in this particular game. It also could be, maybe this is what I hope, just because of how well this DLC went, is the final DLC pack, I think it was Blood and Wine for The Witcher 3, that was like literally like a whole game within itself. It was crazy good. And I almost hope that that's what it is, where it continues Link's journey into a new way. And I think what's interesting about that is Zelda has never really... I always say, like, I've always wanted Zelda to end on a cliffhanger. Oh, it's never going to.
Oh my gosh, that would drive me crazy.
Yeah, it drives everyone crazy. But see, Breath of the Wild, knowing there's DLC in the future, like, you completed the main objective, right?
It could happen.
Your main objective, your main objective was to stop Calamity Ganon. So, like, you're going to stop him in the main game. But what if there's clearly something hinted at more?
Yeah.
But you're just kind of left hanging until it happens later.
Which would be probably... if that was, like, a cliffhanger leading into the DLC, that would sell the DLC like crazy, I'm sure. You know, not that it's not going to do well in the first place, because it's Zelda. First time for Zelda DLC besides Triforce Heroes, I believe. But, you know, I feel like that would do well if that was what the situation was.
So, this next person over on Facebook, this should be a quick one, because I think this is, again, just, you know, not knowing the full lore behind the Zelda series. Matt Johnson, he asked, you know, are we going to be able to drink alcohol in Breath of the Wild, since the ESRB rating has an alcohol reference in it? And then he clarifies, not that I would want Link to get drunk. And if you do get drunk, can it kill you? Obviously, we don't know, you know, if you can get so drunk you die.
That's just more of a curiosity question.
Yeah. But to clarify, the ongoing thing in Zelda is that milk is alcohol. This is not really, like, hinted at very well throughout the series, beyond places like Majora's Mask or A Link Between Worlds with the milk bar.
Wasn't Telma's bar...
I don't even remember what they served at Telma's bar.
I don't either.
To be honest, I don't know if they actually served real alcohol there, if they were serving milk. But, like, the ongoing thing in Zelda is that, like, milk is not like milk here. It is their equivalent to alcohol. So, like,
some
pumpkin. And again, that started in Majora's Mask, with the reference that, like, you're not old enough to drink this milk. And clearly, like, people who are addicted to it and constantly coming to that particular bar all the time. And then obviously in A Link Between Worlds, where it had a drunk guy in there, believe it or not. There's a drunk guy who drank too much milk in A Link Between Worlds. So, like, this isn't actually new for the series, for there to be references to someone being drunk and milk being what got them drunk. So, like, history of the Zelda series tells you this isn't actually new. It is, like, the first time it's been listed in the ESRB rating. And it's probably specifically because the guy who is drunk is very, very obviously drunk. Like, stumbling over himself, mumbling, burping. Like, other games haven't been so blatant about it. A Link Between Worlds, we call it a milk bar, but the guy that was drunk was basically passed out at the bar. So it's a very subtle thing that I don't think a lot of children would get. Majora's Mask, again, if you are a child, you probably didn't understand what the context of those words meant. But in this game, it'll be a very indistinguishable. Like, there's no way you can look at this character and not know he's drunk. Hence, they have to mention it in their rating. Why? I have no idea. Because, like, in The Witcher, people are drunk in that game all the time, and that's not mentioned in the rating. So I don't know why the ESRB chooses to mention these things. But, yeah. So just so you know, we'll probably be able to drink milk. Because we've been able to do it before. It's never actually gotten Link drunk. So I don't think we can get drunk off of it. But maybe we can. Maybe that's why they have a character who is acting so drunk. Because it does blur our vision and make us, you know, do weird things. Which is not a new thing in gaming, but that would be new for Zelda.
Romani milk,
Lan milk, all the different kinds of milk you could throw in there. It's an open world game, baby. Who knows how many different ranchers there are? So yeah, so just to kind of, I just wanted to give you a little, kind of a little Zelda history lesson.
It's
kind of
cool though.
Yeah. Something odd about that. In Breath of the Wild, we've seen tons of wildlife, but I can't think of a time that we've actually seen a cow.
You don't need a cow for milk. Goats.
Okay.
Yeah, milk will just come from cows.
True.
You're thinking too traditional here. That's the thing. That's what gives you the different variations of milk.
Yeah.
Well, of course we haven't seen cows yet. We've only seen like 1% of the world, remember?
True.
We haven't even seen a ranch. Like, where's this milk coming from? What are those cows eating that it becomes alcohol? That's what I want to know. Anyways, magic. It's Zelda. It just is. It's really weird too. I wonder who, at one point during what, like, well, I don't know whether it was Majora's Mask, so some game development where some guy in the development team's like, dude, I'm gonna put in a reference that milk is alcohol, like, an innocent children's like drink is not alcohol. Like, I just want to know who came up with that idea. That's maybe a question I might have to ask Eiji Nomo if I get to interview him someday. Be like, so who came up with this concept? Because it's crazy. It just is, like, who would think to make that alcohol? You could just include alcohol, but nope. Or even just wine, you know, like, whatever. Anyways, moving on. Speaking of Breath of the Wild, so this is the final fan topic we have. And this is kind of good because, like, I want to transition into talking a bit about Breath of the Wild, because Breath of the Wild basically comes out a week from now, which is crazy.
Yeah. Time flies.
Feels like we've been waiting most of our lives.
Yeah.
I mean, Mason himself was just becoming a teenager when the game went to production.
Oh, well, how old was I when that would have released? Okay, I'm 19 now. At E3, when I started production, I would have been, what, probably 14-ish. Oh, my gosh. I'm old.
So, like, okay. 2011?
Yeah, you're so old.
No. Yeah, it was 2011, I think, and I would have been, depending on the month, I would have been 15. So
that is insane.
Because I would have been.
You would have been. You would have been 15. 14. I was gonna say you'd be 21 today.
Right. No, I don't even know. It's just crazy. Like, we've heard about this game. It's been in development for so long. Zelda Wii U is all we knew it as until E3 2014, I believe. Yeah. And then it was supposed to release 2015. Oh no, it's coming next year, 2016. Like, no, it's coming in March of next year. So
I still can't believe it's even coming out, because
yeah.
It just keeps getting delayed. I just keep waiting for, like, them to come out next week and just be like, you know what, guys? Sorry, we didn't produce enough Switch units. We got to push everything back to summer.
Don't jinx it, please.
Oh, sorry, we're going holiday. And then it's like, oh, man, we found a fatal flaw, so we got to remake all the Switches. So now we're looking at 2018. Oh,
poor guys camping out in Nintendo New York right now.
Those review copies. Everyone send them back. You never played them.
Interesting.
You never played them.
Someone said... Or I was listening to a different podcast, and they were talking about how they think that the Nintendo Switch, the reason that, like, Nintendo didn't announce too much for it, like whether it would have Netflix, YouTube, all these other apps that come, it's common sense to have them on consoles now, but we don't necessarily know when the Switch is going to get them. And they were talking about how where they delayed Breath of the Wild for so long so they could have the dual release on the Switch and the Wii U instead of just letting it die out on the Wii U, which a lot of people thought would happen, that they rushed the Switch for the launch of Breath of the Wild is what they were kind of talking about, because they said if Breath of the Wild would have just launched on the Wii U and not the Switch, then the Switch would have came out later this year and had Mario and all of these other features and all of these other games. They're having to release the Switch, and then you'll get your lineup of games and your different Netflix, Hulu features and all of that.
Either way, I'm glad the Switch is coming out when it is, because I would hate to see it release the same time Scorpio does.
Yeah.
And that wouldn't end well.
Because, the thing is, like, it's a totally different thing than what Scorpio is, so maybe it wouldn't affect sales at all. But you can't tell me that video game media wouldn't basically overlook the Switch.
They would compare it somehow. They'd find a way, you know?
Well, it would just be more like IGN's just going to be sitting there the whole time, you know, like, their entire front page is going to be all Scorpio.
Yeah.
You're not going to see Nintendo except for like a footnote.
Or a little Switch review says 7.8, too much technology.
It's like how something you go like into
technology.
It's like how too you go much into water. GameStop or some video game store and they'll have the Xbox wall, the PlayStation wall, and then if you're lucky, there's like a little shelf in the middle with some Wii U games.
Well, and that's the thing too. Like, it feels weird right now, right? Because you know, I just went to GameStop and paid off some stuff. You know, I go to Walmart all the time. I go to the stores a lot because I have kids and you always need something.
Diapers. Yes.
I'm sure Jesse can relate a little bit with that. As I'm in these stores that have like electronic sections, there are like ads and all this stuff up for the Switch. That I don't know that would actually be there if it would have went head to head with Scorpio ads this winter. Like the sections would still be there. Like GameStop would still have a Switch section. It just might be even smaller with less. Like it feels weird. I pull up to the GameStop today. Literally, they have four front facing windows. Three of those windows are advertising Switch.
That's insane.
One is advertising like Horizon that comes out. So it's like, that's never happened at my GameStop. They've never been that much Nintendo advertising before. And obviously, Nintendo paid for it and is really pushing it.
I mean,
but Microsoft is going to be pushing it hardcore, too. And then you got Nintendo and Microsoft pushing at the same time. It's going to favor Microsoft because GameStop does more business.
Just the other day, there was the patents that came out where PlayStation had a similar patent to what the Switch is. But it's not their hybrid console. It's just their handheld. And likely, it'll be more powerful than what the Switch is, which Nintendo.
It was supposed to be the next Vita, basically.
It looks so ugly. I saw
whether that. Whether or not it ever comes out, it sounded like Sony, based on comments from their CEO, it sounds like they're kind of done trying to make handhelds. But like that's what their next handheld was supposed to be, before they canned Vita, and are kind of running away from it as far as we're aware. Who knows? We could hit next year and then another, you know, PSP.
The Vita is really cool, though. Not for... Well, some of the Vita games are cool, but I really like the remote play, which...
I like the OLED screens, man. Oh, they're so expensive, but man. Like, if a Switch could have an OLED screen... I mean, the screen it has apparently is really nice, but if it was OLED, oh my god. Of course, then we're talking about, like, a $400 system, so... So getting into the last topic that we had submitted about for a while. It's totally fine. This is exciting times we have here. You know, we have a new Nintendo console coming out, guys.
Yeah.
It's crazy. So if Breath of the Wild, this comes from Evan Marino, does reunite the timelines, it's a popular theory out there, won't it immediately split the timeline again because of the alternate endings? How the heck will they handle this? And then he also has a second topic where we could talk about the history of the Koroks. So, timeline goodness.
Any when thoughts? People bring that up, at first I thought, yeah, that's interesting. It has the Temple of Time, which looks like it was plucked out of Ocarina of Time. It has Hyrule Castle Town looking like it was plucked out of Twilight Princess. It has the Koroks, the Deku Tree, or whatever, looking like it was plucked out of Wind Waker. So it made sense. It has elements from all of these Zelda games. But then...
And Calamity Ganon, where Ganon comes from the Downfall
Timeline. I forgot which interview. I've watched so many with Aonuma and Miyamoto, and a lot of them just give the same answers to the same questions. But there was... He said that... Something along the lines of, although the art style and certain assets like the Koroks are from the Wind Waker, the story itself doesn't relate to the Wind Waker. So that immediately tells me that it could take place so long after Wind Waker, or not necessarily before Wind Waker, because there's not that much time difference, but it could take place so far away from the Wind Waker that the story itself has no relation to the Wind Waker. But I take it as it's not in that timeline at all. And then he also follows it up with, it takes place in a time where Hyrule has had many battles with Ganon. So that puts it at the end of the child timeline, so after Twilight Princess and Four Swords Adventure, or somewhere in the middle, or towards the end of the Downfall timeline. And it can't necessarily be a connection of all three, because if it did connect all three, then it would link back to Wind Waker, where he said it doesn't.
See, I took those comments differently, which, of course, that's obviously, he's vague, so everything ends up, you know, up for interpretation. So he's made that comment all the time, and he also made a comment about, in the interview with Game Informer, where he also said, like, I'm not going to tell you where this game takes place in the timeline, but as you play it, its placement will become clear. So it's not going to be a game that leaves us hanging. By the end of the game, we're going to know where it goes. That's at least what he's telling us. Because a lot of times, you know, you play a Zelda game, at least in the past, you don't necessarily know where it goes unless he told you. But that's not going to be the case with this game. So when he made that comment about Wind Waker, I viewed it as what he was trying to say is that this game isn't directly related to Wind Waker. Like, this isn't the game that explains the Flood, and this isn't the game that takes place after Spirit Tracks, per se, in terms of continuing any Wind Waker-esque story. Which, to me, means it doesn't necessarily take place on that timeline, but it doesn't get rid of the fact it could still be a unified timeline game, because then it doesn't take place on any timeline. So it's not really directly related to any of the games. Instead, it's more of a culmination of all the games. So it would be incorrect to say, because of Korok's, it's related to Wind Waker, or because of the Temple of Time, it's related to Ocarina of Time. It would be more correct to say, because of all of these elements, it's related to the entire series. And how it approaches everything explains how that's possible. Which, again, gets into like the Dragon Break theory, which was posted up by on the Nintendo Prime channel by our very own Mr. Daniel. The thing is, like, the United Timeline isn't a new theory, but how he approached it with Dragon Break was very smart. So if you haven't seen that, I'll put a link down in the description. You guys should really check out that Dragon Break theory. I can't even begin to explain it as well as he did. Yeah, it's Elder Scrolls reference, because Elder Scrolls has multiple endings in many of the games, and yet everything seems to continue on a continuous timeline, and the Dragon Break theory explains why that's possible.
To put it simply, I believe the video explains the Elder Scrolls had a game where it had alternative endings, and it kind of really screwed up the timeline, so in a following game, they just converged all of the alternate timelines, taking pieces from each one, so very simple premise.
Yep. And this is important to consider when we're talking about Breath of the Wild, because Evan Marino says if Breath of the Wild does reunite the timeline, so under the presumption that it does that, you know, isn't it going to split it right away? And the same logic in the Dragon Break theory that can be used to explain why Breath of the Wild can unite the timeline would also explain why it having multiple endings doesn't matter. And that's because the Dragon Break theory essentially is about, no matter where you end up, everything converges to the same thing. So whether I decided this morning to put pants on or I decided to wear shorts, no matter what, either decision ends up in the same spot at the end of the day. And that's kind of the bare bones basics behind the Dragon Break theory. Is no matter how the game ended, like in Spirit Tracks, how if you did it one way, you ended being a conductor on the train. If you did it another way, you ended kneeling to Princess Zelda in the castle. But no matter what way you went, the events that happened after that still happened the same way. So that's kind of the basis of it. And that's what would happen with Breath of the Wild, where if it brought everything together, that's an easy way to explain it. And having the alternate endings, it could still be explained simply with another Dragon Break, where it doesn't matter where you end, because whatever happens next happens anyways.
The way you explain it reminds me a lot of Majora's Mask. If you help out as many people as you can, or if you help out as few people as you can, whenever you defeat Majora and you save the world, either way the moon's not going to fall, everybody's basically saved. So you still get a similar outcome.
Yeah. I mean, the thing is, that doesn't mean there's not individual impact on different characters. Like, obviously, you know, Andrew and Kathy, maybe that never happens and stuff. But overall, it doesn't impact where everything goes at the end of the day. Link still stops the moon. He still goes back to Hyrule, still has kids, and the Twilight Princess still happens. So, that's kind of the premise behind a Dragon Break, and that's why games having multiple endings doesn't necessarily mean anything in terms of the future. At least that's what they used for you know, Skyrim and Oblivion and all that stuff. So that's kind of, I guess, the explanation I would believe, like, if this game does reunite the timelines, which, ignoring all evidence that points to whether it does or not, I think needs to happen anyways, because the timeline is too convoluted. And I think it really restricts them, and I think Breath of the Wild offers a unique opportunity for them to wipe the slate and bring the whole series together and set what they want to do moving forward in the future, rather than being like, we're only wiping the slate in a single timeline. I think it'd be smart for them to reunite the timeline, but whatever. Nintendo could do what they want. As I said, they pulled the downfall timeline out of their butt, so who knows what they're doing here. Because, like, and I know some people might like the downfall timeline, maybe. The excuse for it is silly, because that excuse exists with every game. Link failed. Okay, well, he could fail in any game. So it's just... anyways. Plus, then it brings the whole multiverse theory in, and then really, there isn't three splits. There's an infinite amount. We just haven't played the games on those splits yet. Anyways, timeline theories, man. They really bug me ever since they introduced that third split. When it was just two, it just made a lot more sense to me. Anyways, so one last thing I wanted to talk about. And maybe this is a way to get our dear old Mason talking a bit more.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's no surprise. A lot of fans of Nintendo Prime probably love Zelda. So they really wanted us to get some in-depth on some particulars that...
It's just like the topics are like from older games that I haven't really had a chance to try out
yet. Yeah, no. So no,
is informative, like, enough. So that's I'm what's learning, cool. So
that's why I like having you on here. Because, like, one, you get informed,
right?
And two, when you do talk, you kind of provide a different perspective,
right?
Because obviously, you know, Jesse and I are veterans of the series, right, and you're newer to the series,
right? From the Wind Waker HD,
the old youngin days,
yeah,
youngin days.
That's just crazy.
I'd like to say there was a time I was new to the series, but the time I was new to the series was back in the 80s.
My first Zelda game was Link to the Past, which I know there's a lot of people, like, one of my old bosses at GameStop said he was already basically an adult whenever the first Zelda game came out. And then for me, whenever I was a child getting introduced to the series, it was Link to the Past and Twilight Princess, which with you came, you know, while you were probably becoming an adult. Not really sure how old you are, but for me it's always crazy whenever I hear other people saying, like, Twilight Princess or Spirit Tracks was their first Zelda game, because to me it's like that didn't come until I was already, like, addicted to the franchise and had, like, several games in. But yeah,
so the topic I want to bring up has obviously to do with Breath of the Wild. I mean, it only feels appropriate we end talking about Breath of the Wild on this first episode, since that is the game coming up. In fact, don't be surprised, folks, if in the future a lot of the next 10 or so Zelda Inquiries episodes are a lot of Breath of the Wild, because there's a new Zelda game coming out. Don't know if you heard about it. Kind of a big deal. What I want to know is, like, what are you hoping to get out of Breath of the Wild? Like, when you play this game, what do you want your takeaway to be at the end?
See,
and we'll start with Mason, since he hasn't had a lot to say.
Okay, see, I feel like with this game, they are going on a very different approach as to other Zelda games, because if you take a look at how massive this world is to start out, this world is 12 times larger than that of Twilight Princess. And that is something that blew a lot of people's minds, including my own, because at the time I had just gotten Twilight Princess HD for Wii U, and I'm like, wow, you know, I thought this was kind of a big world. But no, what they explored at E3 during the Treehouse streams were only less than 2% of the entire world, which was insane considering they did a good 8 or 9 hours that day showing off the game. And it's crazy to think that there's that much to do almost. And I don't want it to feel like it's going to be empty in any way. I like the whole nature aspect, I feel like, is what they're shooting for, because exploration is kind of what the whole theme of it is, I feel like. Just going around looking at everything, but then like you just have so many things that are like nature-esque. You know, like, there's just so much going on in the world. Everything is so alive and free. You know, you have horses running through the wild. You have, you know, all this stuff. And it's great to be able to think that maybe you'd be able to just, you know, run loose and let, you know, let yourself go and just do whatever and explore. And I mean, I feel like out of anything, that would be the biggest key factor Nintendo's shooting for, because it's the Breath of the Wild, you know, you got to go explore outdoors. And it's just weird to think about how, I don't know, hardly even think about the timeline situation and stuff, but for people that do, to watch all of it come together throughout the game, it's going to be very interesting. Just taking away like the rustic look of the Temple of Time and everything going on, and it's a very cool thing to think about, just in terms of the exploration factor. But as the story itself, they've been talking about how, you know, it's going to be much more in depth, it's going to have a lot more emotion considering voice acting is a thing now, and I feel like it's going to be more of like a movie that you're a part of in a way. You know, I just think overall it's going to be a massive, like, take you in kind of experience. That's what I'm hoping for. So
nice.
For me, Jesse, what personally do you got? I want Breath of the Wild to be that game for Nintendo that brings them back to the mainstream audience. Like, obviously a lot of people think of Metroid or Star Fox to be the hardcore Nintendo fan games, but I hope this is the game that all of the people that are now in love with games like the upcoming Horizon Zero Dawn or Uncharted 4 on the PlayStation 4, or the people that are playing all of the Xbox exclusives, I hope this is the game that they look at. And in the past, they may have looked at like Super Mario 3D World or Mario Kart, Pikmin, and been like, well, those aren't necessarily the games that I want to play. I hope Breath of the Wild is the game that kind of reaches out of the inclusive Nintendo bubble that seems like it's been shrinking and shrinking over the years, and kind of reach into all of the other gamers and bring them in. That way, if Nintendo sees, oh, we went all out on this Zelda game, if it fails, maybe we should kind of hold back and do something smaller for the next one. But if it does really well, maybe they'll look at it and be like, okay, well, how can we've evolved the series this much and it did really great. Do we release another one and kind of double up on that? Or do we try to change it even further and create something even bigger, even better for the next Zelda game? So I hope it does that. Just kind of being a mainstream success for me. I know it's going to be awesome. It's, from what I've seen of it, it's likely going to be automatically one of my favorite Zelda games. Unless the story somehow just turns out to be really, really bad, which is doubtful. But I just hope, as I was saying, it reaches out and pulls in people that wouldn't necessarily sit down and play a Nintendo game and bring them into the Zelda fan base.
Yeah, that's you guys both touch on some interesting stuff. All I really hope out of this game, outside of, you know, the obvious that I hope it's the best Zelda game ever. I don't really care about fishing. Am I like the only Zelda fan that doesn't care about fishing?
About fishing?
Yeah.
I don't care about it. Not
like, anyone think it was weird that, like, so you had fishing in Ocarina of Time, you had it in Twilight Princess, they added it in Majora's Mask 3D.
They kind of have it in Wind Waker. You know,
why wasn't it in Wind Waker? Well, you have the time. I didn't really care for it in Twilight Princess, which is odd because you could basically fish anywhere there was water in that game. But whenever, maybe it was just that I was a kid when I was playing it, like 11, 12 year old or however old I was. Maybe it was just that, and, you know, spending however long you could with your friend making like a meta game out of it. Who can catch the biggest fish?
Yeah, who can catch the biggest? Yeah, it, I don't know. I've just never been into fishing, to be honest. And then the only game I think I might have been into it would have been Wind Waker, when I literally spend the whole game in a boat. And exactly. I don't get the fish. I get to find treasure chests, yeah. But that's not
fishing. If while you was on the boat, that's if you could fishing. Just throw out a large fish net and bring in a huge bag.
Yeah, like, oh, I could throw a bait so a fish pops up that I can't you. Catch. Who cares? I got tingle for that. Oh, my gosh. Anyways, I just really did this. Such a hard to follow up after those comments. Outside of the obvious that I hope this is the best Zelda game ever released, because I think it has the potential. I think any Zelda game that releases has the potential. Some have higher potential than others, like Triforce Heroes had the potential to be the best, but it was a pretty low potential because of how different from the series it was in terms of multiplayer aspects. But then you have Breath of the Wild, which takes everything traditional Zelda does, turns it on its head, and does even more of it. Like, it goes old school and new school all at the same time. And I have some concerns with this approach, especially since, and I know it feels weird, but because Horizon releases so close to it, literally within days, like, it almost might put unfair expectations on Breath of the Wild. But at the same point, Breath of the Wild, all it needs to do to me is do enough in terms of gaining critical praise and in terms of gaining sales that it becomes what Nintendo chooses to explore with Zelda in the future. Like, as an example, I don't think Ocarina of Time is the best Zelda game out there. In fact, it's like in my bottom third of all Zelda games. You just got
50 dislikes.
And it's okay. You know how many times these people on the channel have heard it if they've been following us for a while? But my point in saying that is, even though that is how I personally feel, I still recognize it as the last Zelda game to release that set the standards for what Zelda would be moving forward. There hasn't been a new game that has done that since. Mm-hmm. Skyward Sword tried to do that, obviously failed. So I'm hoping that that's what this game does. That, like, how it approaches things is just how Zelda's going to be. I want to be, like, it introduced this physics engine. Every Zelda game moving forward is going to have this physics engine. It set an open world setting. Every Zelda game for, say, the next decade or so mm-hmm. is going to be open world. Which, at the rate they release Zelda games, that only means one game, because one every 6 years. But you know what I mean. Maybe two. Yeah, maybe they can finally get it down to just 5 years.
Aonuma was interviewed saying he would like to bring the development time for home console Zelda games to around 3 years.
And he could argue he's about to pull that off, because he just stated in an interview that they would like to release a 2D Zelda game on the Switch. And since Switch is a home console, that's a home console game.
Yeah,
I can see them pulling that excuse out. Even though that's not what he meant. He's going to say that's what he meant. See? It's mm-hmm. a 2D home console game. We never said it had to be 2D or 3D. Anyways, so I just think it needs to be that game. What it needs to do to become that game, I don't know. Obviously, it has to have critical reception, and it has to sell really, really well. Ideally, I would like it to be the best-selling game in franchise history.
This was probably made up or something, I don't know. But I seen someone had posted something saying that Breath of the Wild needed to sell 2 million copies to break even.
Yep. And it will. And the only way I could, I you know, for starters, there hasn't been a console Zelda game that's ever sold less than 2 million. I think even Four Swords Adventure sold over 2 million, if I remember right. And that's a game that clearly didn't need to sell 2 million to be profitable. And that's not saying, like, that's nothing against Four Swords Adventure. It just isn't that kind of game that's really expensive to make. Capcom. But, you know, you look at just Switch sales alone. Who is buying a Switch in March? Those first 2 million units and not buying Switch. Zelda for it.
Bomberman.
Well, no, I'm actually excited for 1-2 Switch. I almost pre-ordered it today. I keep begging my Nintendo rep to get it for free, so I don't have to pre-order it because I do think it's too expensive. But I don't know because I guess I haven't played it, so maybe it's not too expensive. I don't know. But that's my personal viewpoint until reviews come out. Now, if reviews come out and they tell me differently, I'll go out and I'll get it on day one. Because it is a game I'm highly interested in because I really want to try out all those HD Rumble features. And I know that might sound like a cop-out. Like, I really, really want to try out those HD Rumble features. I've heard they're amazing. And if I don't have one, I don't have one to Switch, I can't do
it's
that.
It's not worth it.
Plus, I think... Plus, I think 1-2 Switch would look hilarious live streaming. So, there is an entertainment factor to it as well. Plus, just getting in a milking competition with my best friend would just be awesome. So I have other reasons. So I literally almost purchased it today. I know I'm going to probably end up giving in, but I'm trying to resist. Trying to resist. Because I don't actually want it that bad. I'd almost rather pick up Bomberman. But anyways, I want all the Switch launch games, to be clear. But finances. Priorities. I need to spend like $500 on Breath of the Wild first. Because I got the special edition, plus the collector's guide, plus all the amiibo. I probably spent more on just Breath of the Wild day one than I spent on the actual
So jealous Switch. Seeing like IGN and all the other people sharing their huge boxes of like five different amiibo.
Yeah, it's Breath of the Wild. I technically still work at Zelda Informer. Where is my big box of goodies? Not coming. That's where. Anyways, no. So it just needs to be that game. That game that sets the standard for Zelda moving forward. And that's something I'll always give Ocarina of Time credit for, at least partial credit. I think A Link to the Past set up the formula, but I think Ocarina of Time solidified it in the 3D space. So those two games in conjunction kind of set up what Zelda has been ever since. And that's what I hope Breath of the Wild does, and I think it's going to take... It doesn't need to take highest rated game of all time, like Ocarina of Time is, but it does need to take a game that scores really, really well, but most importantly, sells really well. And... I'm talking like Twilight Princess, I think, is the best sales on a single platform, if I remember right. When I read it, maybe it was
I
best
know it
combined
was
sales,
best combined sales, but I don't know if it was best single sales.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know if
know
it
Ocarina
actually beat
Time
Ocarina of Time
had the
in
record
terms of single console.
For the most pre-orders.
For single console. Oh, yes, it did. So, obviously, I hope it does that. And by the end of the year, I'm hoping that it tops those games. Which means it has to sell anywhere between 8 and 10 million units. I would love to see it sell over 10, just because, to me, once you hit that 10 million unit mark, that's when you've hit massive critical success in terms of sales. Like, that's when you can start talking about being compared to Red Dead Redemption and Call of Duty and all those other games that sell tens of millions of copies. Zelda has never been that. It's always been, we sell our 4 to 6, and that's we're done with it. Unless it's a handheld game, and then it usually sells between 2 to 3 or 1 to 2, depending on the kind of game it is. Like, I think Triforce Heroes only sold just over 1 million.
Though.
So, I love Triforce Heroes. I love it. But, yeah, it's one of those things that it just needs to be a massive sales success with a decent enough critical reception, like a 9 out of 10. And that's all I'm really hoping to get out of it. Like emotionally, I want a lot more. There's a lot of story stuff I want out of it. There's a lot of expectations I'm putting on the game that probably it can never live up to. But as long as it sets up the future of the series, I will be happy. Because that's what this game is doing is what I want the future of Zelda to be. I want this not to be the last open world Zelda game. I don't want it to be like Skyward Sword where it's a one and done. I want it there to be more of this. I want this physics engine to just be standard. Like, never go away. Even a 2D game, find a way to put it in there. I don't know.
I think there was
this physics engine's amazing.
Where they said that they've invested so much time and resources into the engine of Breath of the Wild that they wanted to reuse it for other games outside of the Zelda series. And at first look...
And that's fine.
Yeah.
I just care about the Zelda series.
I thought
right
that
now.
It was the same engine they used with the new Mario game, because that seems like it's going to be a new open world Mario game too. So for them to reuse, they don't have to reuse everything. But
maybe. Yeah, I haven't seen a lot of physics in there yet.
But that's not something that they've done that just, before. Like Ocarina of Time and Mario 64 reused the same engine.
Yeah. I just hope to see more Zelda games like it. You know, I like what they're doing with the breakable items. I don't know if that's going to be a one and done idea. They've explored it before, and now they're going all out with it. I like it. We'll see if I like it over the full course of the game. You know, I like the equipment system. I like a lot of the RPG elements. That's stuff I'd like to see continued. But the big two takeaways is I want future Zelda games to be open world, and I want future Zelda games to have that physics engine. And if that happens, that means Breath of the Wild set a new standard. So that's what I'm hoping for. We'll see. We have no idea. Breath of the Wild has me. It is the most hyped for a game I have ever been in my life.
E3 award. And it was the only Nintendo game shown off.
I spent like $3,000 to go to E3, and that's all I did. I just kept getting back in line for Zelda. That's why I have so many coins and t-shirts. Because, like, that's all I wanted to do is play Zelda. And, like, I wanted to try Horizon. I wanted to try out these other things. I'm like, no, I need more Zelda. I played that demo once, and I'm like, it's done. No. Yeah,
didn't you say they gave you an extended demo, though? One of the
time? Yes. Well, what happened was when I went up for the booth tour, usually for their booth tours, you would actually tour the booth and then you're taken to a VIP area to play the game without waiting in line. So basically it's a way to guarantee you play the game without waiting in line. That's kind of the idea. And I literally said, look, I've been inside this booth for 3 straight days. I just want to play more Zelda. And the guy's like, sweet. I'll take you up to the area. You'll probably have time to go through that demo a few times. Have fun. And that's what I did. Unfortunately, the booth tour means you don't get the t-shirt. So I have like one more coin than I do t-shirts, but it's okay. I'm like, really? I'm like, I guess the t-shirt's what your reward is for waiting.
Are these the same coins that they're giving out with the collector's edition of Breath of the Wild?
Yes. Yeah, the exact same coins. That's why I'm like, even though I'm going to unbox it, I think I'm going to end up giving away a coin. Like, I've been meaning to for a while. Like, Mason actually at one point offered to buy one from me.
Yeah, those were the days. Now we both have our own.
Yeah, and I'm like, maybe. I'm like, yeah. I know, and now it's like, just as I was thinking the other day, I'm like, oh, man, you know, maybe I should get rid of some of these coins. Well, now the prices are all tanking.
Because it's going
to
be
They come with all the collector's editions. Yeah, so it's like, I lost out on my chance to get maximum value. It's okay. I mean, you guys can't see it right now. I'm showing it on camera. You know that I had these coins. It wasn't until like a month or two after I got them that I realized the cases actually open up.
Oh, yeah. You didn't know that?
And you could take the coin out. Yeah. I had no idea.
So do the ones from like the Nintendo New York launch, or they had the ones for the year Luigi. It does the same thing, or the Smash coins from the Best Buy event.
Yeah, I had no idea these things opened.
Yeah,
like I saw the Nintendo sticker, but I'm like, these look like permanent sealed in things. Like, why would you open it? What are you gonna do with it? Yeah. So I'm like, there's no way this thing opens. I dropped one and it popped open. Yeah. And I actually have it open on camera right now. Try get a nice up view here. You know, of what the coin's gonna look like. And it's like, ew, I guess I could prove I have all these coins. I always talk about it, but no one ever sees them. Like, literally, I'm the only person that ever sees all these coins. So, like, here's the 4 that are opened. Here's my sealed, never opened coin that I don't know why. Because if you look closely, you probably can't tell on the camera, the case on this one's actually cracked. And it was cracked when I got it. So it's not technically mint condition. So I'm hoping that the one that comes with the collector's edition is sealed. But yeah, I don't need all these coins. My original goal was I have in my background I have the Zelda Yahtzee thing. I wanted to take the chest out of it and fill it with Breath of the Wild coins. But I realized that I do not have enough of them to do that, and it's too expensive for me to get enough of them.
Dreams.
So at some point, folks. Folks, if you guys ask, I might be willing to give away some of these coins, because they're cool. I can't give away the t-shirts. I've worn all of them, and even though you guys might still want them,
you
could
do
t-shirts wear out.
You could do t-shirts a thing towards coins, like whoever asks the most interesting question for the next.
Exactly. And since we're at the end of Zelda Inquiries for this week, the inaugural episode, I just do want to remind you guys, if you have any questions or any topics you would like us to talk about, please submit them down in the comments below. Of course, I want to say a big thank you to Jesse and Mason. You guys can, right here at the end of this, little thingamajigger, this end of this video, I will throw up links to your guys' YouTube channels. Do you guys have any particular videos you want to throw a little shout out yet?
You go first, Jesse.
The most interesting video that I've done lately is a video of what I think is next for the Zelda series. Usually lately I've been covering news and stuff that's going to get dated, but I think that video in particular is the one that's going to have interest for the longest, especially when Breath of the Wild actually comes out, people beat it, and then they're like, okay, well, when's the next one? And in that video, I'll talk about how Aonuma has been hinting at the next 2D Zelda game. There could be a third-party developer working on a Zelda game that's unannounced. That's always a possibility. Like, we had, you know, Minish Cap and the Four Swords with Capcom. Grezzo worked on the remakes. Tantalus did Twilight Princess, so there could be a non-Nintendo Zelda game coming sometime. It talks about all of that possibility, so check that video out if that's what you're interested in.
Nice. Mason, what do you got cooking?
All right, well, I got a lot of Switch stuff coming up, lots of videos hyping that up until launch, and I got basically, I had the opportunity to go to New York City and see Captain Nintendo Dude and Triforce Johnson that I, you know, got to talk to them about their wait for the Switch and stuff. Since it's all in that kind of general theme with the Switch and all, I talked to them, and we're also giving away signed amiibos on that video signed by them. So there's a Boo and a Sheik amiibo each that they've signed. I'm going to be shipping out to whoever, you know. So there's that. It was really cool to see them, though, and, you know, just general New York. It was good, but that's pretty much the only thing. And then just general other stuff going on my channel. I'm uploading a lot, so there's a lot going on. So yeah.
I'm going to be checking the channel out, too.
That's a check.
Do what?
Yeah, no. Yeah, Mason makes good stuff. Obviously, you know, Captain Nintendo Dude, I'm sure many of you, our viewers, probably know who he is because his channel's a lot bigger than ours.
Oh, yeah.
But if you don't, you could obviously go check him out. He... For our viewers that might not know who he is, the only thing you really need to know now, because, you know, he's just like a lot of other YouTubers, has his opinions, has his stuff, has some fun, plays some games, lots of Nintendo stuff, is that he is going to be the first person to officially have a retail Switch, as in official, as in something that the Guinness Book of World Records would recognize.
Stolen.
Then the torch is being handed over from Triforce Johnson, who is the current world record holder for Nintendo console releases at 5 of being the first person. And he's doing that at the Nintendo World Store, and he's currently in the midst of a month of waiting in line, or queuing the line, because the line doesn't technically exist yet. For, like, legal reasons, it doesn't exist yet.
They're having a party, though, so it's a good time.
But they're having a party. They just played Smash the other day, and
Nintendo's bought them donuts, and Ubisoft got them pizza one day.
Pizza, yeah. And I think he's got more Pokemon cards now than he knows what to do with, because people keep buying him Pokemon cards. Good for him. Good for him. He's having a grand old time with us. So maybe I'll throw a link down to his channel, too, down in the description, so you guys can go check him out, because, hey, I'm watching his videos every day. It's good times. I'm a little jealous that he'll be quote-unquote first, even though he'll technically be picking up the Switch basically at the same time I will. Yeah. But I don't have those Reggie handed it to me.
That's the difference.
The Reggie.
Those poor people over in California having to wait the extra 3 hours.
Oh, California. All right, folks. Well, that's gonna wrap it up for the first episode of Zelda Inquiries. Hopefully you enjoyed it. Thank you guys for joining, and we'll catch you guys next week.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Nate.